Welcome to this symposium on Duchamp's Readymades. I cannot tell you how much I have looked forward to this event, since the group collected here is something of a dream team. Except two female scholars, everybody accepted the invitation. So I think we have a unique possibility for discussing new and revisiting old aspects of this subject, which continues to haunt and intrigue historians of art in the 20th and 21st centuries. If any single phenomena should be singled out that heralded that the art of these centuries would look rather different from earlier art forms, it must indeed be the ready-mades. In a poll conducted for Gordon Gin, the sponsor of the Turner Prize in 2004, a large majority of the 500 leading artists, dealers, critics, and curators named Fountain the work of art that has had the most impact on art today. This urinal that in April 1917 was turned around, signed, handed into, but then refused from the exhibition of the Society of Independent Artists in New York, still seems to mock and destabilize the whole horizon of expectance connected to artworks. Skill, originality, taste, aesthetic value, difference from utilitarian technology, distance from bodily functions, even stable objecthood. For that very reason, it is an ever-flowing source for that disruptive and subversive energy which keeps driving contemporary art forms, even if many observers are worried that the art institution since long has domesticated and commercialized the avant-gardistic riot that Fountain participated in initiating. Whereas its closest competitor in the same poll, Picasso's Les Demoiselles d'Avignon from 1907, still makes its revolution in the domain of form, as if, in Braque's words, Picasso had drunk petroleum in order to spit fire on the canvas. Fountain and its small family of other ready-mades make their revolution by completely leaving the battlefield of forms, what Duchamp termed the original. On the one hand, by appropriating pieces of technology that was not produced by Duchamp himself, but by machines, a urinal, a bottle dryer, a duck comb, a snow shovel, an art reproduction, and so on, the ready-mades bring attention to what we could call the thingness of art. That despite all the transformations to which the artist can subject artistic materials, there is still a leftover of something pre-given, a naked materiality imported from the real, non-imaginary world. On the other hand, by minimizing the artist's manual intervention, the ready-mades ultimately turn artistic creation into a question of choice. They thereby shift the attention to the world of the intellect and the institutional setting, domain we since the 1960s have termed the conceptual. In what consists the more or less invisible non-retinal rules that make this particular word a work of art. So, at the same time as the ready-mades stress thingness, they also, and quite paradoxically, minimize the essence of this thingness, making it seemingly interchangeable, as is stressed by the machine-produced origin of the ready-mades, and accordingly the many replicas that were made of them by Duchamp and others. This impersonal mode of art making seems indeed to be fundamental for Duchamp, also when he interferes more closely in the form-giving of materials, as is seen in the large glass that also exists in many copies. It is this doubly material, conceptual move, framing whatever pieces of matter with auras of symbols, that in the hindsight of our time seems to make Duchamp rather than Picasso the most influential artist of modern art, if that is how art after 1900 indeed should be termed. And yet, if this had been a prediction pronounced half a century earlier, One would have thought that the judges of the Gordon's gin poll had been influenced by too much intake of the sponsor's product. For until then, almost nobody in the established art world had taken notice of Fountain and other ready-mades, and certainly not as anything more than a marginal phenomenon. This new type of work seems indeed to have emerged out of nothing for Duchamp himself, who saw the first of these pieces, the bicycle wheel, mounted on a kitchen stool from 1913, as merely a pleasant studio attraction. No, sorry, distraction. Whereas Picasso spit fire on the canvas, setting old forms in flames, characteristically, the circling in vain of this wheel rather reminded Duchamp of a fireplace, flames burning nothing in particular. The very name ready-made was similarly an afterthought, which only occurred to Duchamp after he arrived in New York in the summer of 1915. This notion was apt ammunition for continuing his controversy with the vitalist tendencies of the futurists and puto-cubists, both of which drew upon the French vitalist philosopher Henri Bergson, since the word ready-made translated Bergson's concept of tout fait, the antipode of the organic and the continuous. As Bergson remarks in his widely read essay on laughter from 1900, translated into English in 1911, quote, "The rigid, the ready-made, the mechanical, in contrast with the subtle, the ever-changing, and the living, absent-mindedness in contrast with attention, in a word, automatism in contrast with free activity, such are the defects that laughter singles out and would fain correct," unquote, Bergson. So, by adopting the term ready-made, Duchamp stressed that he was instituting something mechanical, discontinuous, and distracting in an art world that continued to be obsessed with the organic, coherent, and attentive, culminating in the human body. It is this mechanical displacement of the human body I should disclose. That is the reason why this symposium can take place in the framework of a research project called Posthuman Aesthetics. Duchamp adored the grotesque vision of machines intervening in or wholly overtaking human bodies, as seen in the writings of proto-surrealist authors such as Raymond Roussel and Alfred Chéri, and in an interview for NBC in 1956, he remarked directly, quote Duchamp, "By using mechanical techniques in trying to draw a conclusion or consequence from the dehumanization of the work of art, I came to the idea of the ready-mades," unquote. An early anti-humanist, indeed post-human framework, could even be noticed in the issue of the little journal The Blind Man, which followed a month after the refusal of Fountain from the exhibition of the Society of Independent Artists in April 1917. Recalling the speculations of the coming overman in Nietzsche's philosophical novel, Also sprach Zarathustra, from 1883 to 85, contemporary humans are here compared to apes, which are about to lose their tail in a coming evolutionary transformation, but have their heads directed backwards instead of forwards. Is this ornamental tail we are going to lose, but can learn to live without, art? At least in an interview with Francis Roberts towards the end of his life, Duchamp exclaimed with disappointment about the ready-mades, quote, "The fact that they are regarded with the same reverence as objects of art probably means I have failed to solve the problem of trying to do away entirely with art," unquote. Yet, if the ready-made introduction of machine-produced artifacts on the places earlier reserved for organically coherent artworks has a post-human flavor, it is obviously a light one. Associating also to Bergson's context of laughter, the notion of ready-made stresses humor and irony, thereby making understandable Duchamp's initial understanding of the ready-mades as amusing distractions thriving in the periphery of proper artworks. With a strange logic, it was this marginality that seemingly continued with Fountain's refusal. According to Duchamp, although officially refused, it was physically present at the exhibition, displaced from view behind the curtain, until Duchamp dragged it out for photography at Stieglitz Fifth Avenue Gallery 291. Tons of words have been directed at the ready-mades after Duchamp became rediscovered from the late 1940s onwards by artists such as John Cage, Robert Rauschenberg, and Richard Hamilton. So is it at all possible here, 101 years after the non-exhibition of Fountain, to say anything new about them? I think so, for despite the mountains of words, they retain an aura of mystery, which was also the case for Duchamp himself, who said that, quote, "The curious thing about the ready-made is that I've never been able to arrive at a definition or explanation that fully satisfies me. There's still magic in the idea, so I'd rather keep it that way," unquote. So it is my hope that this symposium will readdress a lot of questions that continuously haunt the ready-mades, both in relation to their own time and mostly delayed reception history. A few of these questions could be, should the ready-mades be seen as a special moment in avant-garde history, or have they been fully absorbed by later art movements such as Fluxus, pop art, conceptual art, and relational aesthetics? Were they the result of Duchamp's intentions or of a more collective enterprise, including the Baroness Elsa von Freytag-Loringhofen, who by some are supposed to be the female artist whom Duchamp mentions to his sister Suzanne as the one who sent in the urinal under the pseudonym R. Mutt? Do they stand out from Duchamp's other works, notably The Large Glass from 1915 to 23, or are they intimately woven together with them? In describing how scholars relate to new media, Russian media theorist Lev Manovich distinguishes between Turing land and Duchamp land. Turing land, consisting of techno nerds oriented, quote, towards new state-of-the-art computer technology, unquote, who produce artworks that are simple and usually lacking irony. Duchamp land, consisting of the art world's picky aestheticians who will accept only those art objects that are, quote, oriented towards the content, that are complicated and share an ironic, self-referential, and often literally destructive attitude towards its material, unquote. Do we actually meet a similar division of scholars, or at least a polarity of family resemblances relating to Duchamp's work itself? Turingland scholars being especially interested in all the scientific, pseudo-scientific, technological, and general philosophical problems that are explored in the visualized computer of The Large Glass. Duchampland scholars having their point of gravity in the likely destructive ready-mades, with according questions of gender politics, psychoanalysis, capitalist criticism, migration thinking, institutional politics, art theory, and so on. If so, I hope the shutters between Turingland and Duchampland will open a bit more in this symposium. Whatever might occur, I look forward to the many cross-sections of contexts that Duchamp's ready-mades will undoubtedly meet in the coming 2 days. Welcome.